Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
It says seven more seconds. Okay, the meeting is now in session. Mr. Engel, if you would have the invocation for us.
Let's pray. Kind and most gracious Heavenly Father, we do thank you, Lord, for just the many blessings that you bestowed on each one of us. And Lord, as we come to you now, we just continue to pray, Father, for our troops overseas, those in harm's way. Lord, I just pray for each one, Lord, that you just watch over them and bring them back safely. Lord, we do pray for this board as we attend to the business of the citizens that we serve. Father, just help us to make righteous decisions. Lord, we do pray these things in your precious name. Amen.
Amen. Okay, the public comments. Okay, Mr. Shee.
Good morning, Chair Lady and members of the board. First, I'd like to just briefly comment on these agendas. I was taken aback last time because the isolated spoke. And I was wondering if there wasn't some way you could tree these out. So, you know, it says hire and freeze, and then you could maybe tell who's going to speak so that I wouldn't have went home. And I heard she took some comments later on. Took some questions, and I would have loved to have been there. Now, I just thought that might be helpful. I mean, if you could tree it out that, you know, say it, here it says planning board appointments or say budget amendments, and you could say who's going to just say A, B, C, and who's going to speak. Maybe on something you don't think about. I don't know. It made it made it better on me. And next thing, I'd like to thank Commissioner Sutton for setting me straight on some stuff. We couldn't agree on much, but he talked about this Carolina stuff, and I see where y'all are coming from, finally, due to his taking up the time with me. And the reason I wasn't making any progress was because we were talking to their places. On that Carolina thing, I have really went back on it, and the northern point is so close to what the state calls for. We're talking two different things here. The original line as set out by the state, the act that created the county. That's one separate thing. And it says that is the act that says where the county line goes. And then the other thing is the survey. That's where I've been having my trouble with y'all. And I would just like you to note that if the original act were followed, that the northern point is just about dead on. I can't be so accurate with my working off a computer and not having it. Apparently there was something in the process, and you can check with those geographical, you know, surveying people that knows that. I'm guessing it's magnetic compass that made that thing head off true north-south. Now, and I about bet you that they'll tell you it was because they used magnetic stuff, because I looked at a lot of other county lines, and they seem to do the same thing, kind of, you know, tilt side. Now, I know you don't want a survey, but I would like you to take a look and ask those folks, given that the northern point is almost exactly where it's supposed to be, provided that the original 9 mile survey was correct from the east-west, then a true south line from that northern point, I don't think you would find much resistance from any of the people that you took in if it were run that way. Plus, it would not require, and the way I read it, going to the state, because you're not moving the line. Then the state act calls for the line to be where it is. If you run it to the old survey, then that's when I think you'll be moving the line. And if you go with the map you got now, I think it will require the state, you know, to sign off on it. And I won't take up any more of your time, but just look at it and imagine that north-south line from the north point. And just consider it's pretty close. And the survey's pretty close too, Tim, by the way. But I can still show you, I can still map you three more points on Cane Creek and run it by Hebron Church. Of course, Mibbin will be gone. Thank y'all.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Engel, any comments? Okay. I do want to remind you that we do, and you're okay, we do have a 3-minute that we ask you not to talk more than 3 minutes, and that's only fair for everybody else, too. So, and when you hear that little bell go off, then that means your 3 minutes is up. So, anyway, I think we need just to be fair to everybody. Mr. Childers?
Morning. Happy to meet everybody. I won't be speaking on the county line today. Anyway, today the commissioners, I believe, are being asked to consider changing the present term limits for the planning board and to allow a reappointment of members whose terms have are about to expire. And I'm urging county commissioners to reject the request and to keep the term limits for these reasons. The planning board should attempt to consistently represent the current and differing views of a changing county community. Attempts to lock in established viewpoints of any one community group are not in the best interest of a progressive and diverse citizenry. Planning board decisions should take place only after active and open discussion that represents a variety of positions from all sides of the community. Blocking input from dissimilar views through the elimination of term limits does not serve the entire community, nor does it recognize a possible need for a change in direction from established long-held opinions. I also urge commissioners to adopt a system of broader community outreach and allowing for the application of planning board members. Since planning board members do not hold elected positions, it is then the duty of elected commissioners to ensure that the direction of this community is not unduly influenced by one particular group. We all pay taxes, live in, and contribute to this county, and we all should expect a fair chance to have our different voices determine the direction of this community. So that's all I have to say about that. I'd like to just submit this, if I could, to the record. And if I have a little more time, I'd just like to say, I understand that you may be considering another junk car exemption, another junk car lot for Alamance County. I don't know what the facts are in this case, but we don't need another junkyard lot in Alamance County. So appreciate your time. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. Beverly Kerr.
Beverly Kerr. Good morning. I'm from Graham, Alamance County, and I'm also interested in the planning board appointments. And I'd just like to say that we've been attending some of the meetings. We enjoy them. We find the people there very respectful and knowledgeable. However, I hope that we'll be able to give new people an opportunity to serve on the planning board. And let's make sure that the people know that these appointments are available. Maybe we could do a little more outreach to get in some new blood. Thank you.
Thank you, Beverly. Bill Smith.
Well, I don't know where I need to say anything yet or not, because I'm waiting on Mr. Martin with his high input impact land use. When he talks, I may want to talk.
Okay.
That'll be all right.
Okay. That's fine. That's fine. Okay. That's all the sign-ups I have. So.
Got a hand up.
Yeah. I'm sorry. Okay. You didn't get a chance to sign in. Okay.
That would be
all right. Come on. Come on. And your name?
My name is Susan Dayton. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning, morning. I live in Saxbaha, and I'm here to make a comment concerning the reappointments of the planning board members. I've been attending as many of those planning board meetings as I can, and I understand that there is a request by three current members to have their terms extended. And I would like to urge all of you to just stay with the term limits, the current term limits. I believe it's 2 3-year consecutive terms. As Mr. Childers and Ms. Kerr pointed out, that it gives an ample opportunity for all of the citizens to be involved with the planning process. I myself have been involved in the planning I've been interested in perhaps participating. Unfortunately, there's two people from Newland County that are already on the planning board, but I'd be happy to throw my hat in at any time. But I think that you know, this is a good indication of the folks here today that the public is interested in becoming more involved with the local government. And as far as you know, maybe I've heard that there's a lack of interest on the parts of citizens to attend planning board meetings. And I think that, you know, and I, one idea that I had, I live in Saxpahaw, and it'd be really nice if you can't bring the people in to the planning board meetings, we'll bring the meetings out to the people. And we have plenty of community centers out there. I think it'd be a wonderful time to get out and, you know, meet some of the folks in the surrounding rural areas of Alamance County. So I would urge you all to leave it as it is and let other, you know, let other citizens have an opportunity to take part in local government here in Alamance County. And that's what I have to say today. So thank you very much.
Anyone else? Good morning.
Good morning. I'm Bea Hope from Burlington. And I just want to say that it's a really nice to have new blood come in and bring new ideas. So I'm talking about the planning board, and I don't think anybody ought to be anywhere forever, really. but I offer a plan if you want to compromise. It's always good to stagger the things, draw straws and stagger them in, and that way you get new blood, new ideas. Thank you.
I saw that on the internet. Some of the counties do that. Actually, Wake County does. Anyone else like to speak at this point? Yes, sir.
I'd just like to echo what Bea had said about the planning board and your.
Let's get your name.
Oh, Alan Schluckbeer. I'm from Burlington. I'd just like to support Bea and what she had just said about the planning board. I know that we are all very proud of our democracy, but sometimes we don't give very good examples, especially at the local level. So let's keep this membership staggered as we can and not have permanent members. And sometimes easier to get new ideas and new compromises by having people come in through these kinds of organizations. So let's keep it the way it is. Thank you.
Thank you, Alan. Anyone else like to speak at this point? Yes, ma'am, come on in. State your name, please.
I'm Angie Fawcett, and I'm from Mabin. And I didn't come to speak about the planning board. I'm with Bill and Ralph and them. But I looked on the computer trying to figure out how this planning board was set up or how people got on it, and I didn't figure it all out. But by rights, no one should be allowed on it or anything to do with it or control it that do not live in the county of Alamance. It's concerning Alamance County, and the people of Alamance County are the ones that should be on it and controlling it.
I think they have to live in
Alamance. That's
it. Yeah, they have to live in Alamance County.
They may work outside
Alamance County.
Yeah, they have.
Not one person that I know of that was here the other night said he wasn't from Alamance County anyway.
All right. Is that the one from Caswell? Is that the one from Caswell that you're talking about?
No, he said over there in that front chair. I think he said he's out of Guilford County.
I'm not sure. Art, which meeting are you talking about?
Planning
the planning board?
Planning
board. I wasn't here.
Planning board.
Planning board meeting last Tuesday at 7 o'clock.
Okay. I don't know.
He's in here. I seen him earlier.
He's not a member.
Okay. I don't know that he's a member of the board. Is he a member of the board? I don't think he's a member of the board.
He wasn't. I think she had asked Jason where he lived.
Oh.
That's the one, that's his name, that Martin guy.
Oh, Jason Martin. He's behind you.
He's paid to be an
Alamance. Yeah, he's staff. He's not a member of the planning.
Well, he still should have to come from Alamance County. That's why I said controlling it, because I didn't know if he was a member or what, but I know we took controls a lot of stuff.
He's planning director. Yeah. Okay.
Well, he should be from Alamance County.
Anyone else? Okay, we'll move along. The next is Sherry Hook, and we'll talk about the hiring things at this point.
Madam Chair, members of the board, good morning.
Good morning.
Before the start of the fiscal year, a hiring freeze was enacted, and basically this was a way to help the county weather the changing economic climate by saving on the expenses of salary and benefits for a six-month period of those positions that were vacant at that time. Unfortunately, many of those positions were critical positions either to the safety of the citizens of Alamance County or they were critical to the efficient operations of those departments. And so over time, they were released from the hiring freeze. In releasing these positions, the county was not able to realize all of the savings that they had anticipated from the freeze. While the first quarter revenue results were very strong, another freeze was put in place in October, again as a precautionary measure. In your packet, you've got a spreadsheet that shows the 31 positions that are currently frozen in the county and the estimated cost of these positions with salary and benefits for the remaining 6 months of the fiscal year is $650,210. Based on information gathered from the various department heads, there are 16 positions that we feel are critical needs positions at this time, and those are the positions that are highlighted in yellow on your spreadsheet. The cost of these positions is $299,059 for the remaining 6 months of the fiscal year. The other 15 positions that are on the spreadsheet are still very important to the departments, and their vacancies are causing a strain on the resources of their departments as their duties are being absorbed by other members of the departments. The cost of those 15 positions is $351,150. We're basically bringing this information before the board this morning in hopes of getting some guidance on the current hiring freeze. And what we're looking for the board to guide us on are basically continuing the freeze of these positions, releasing all 31 positions, or releasing those 16 positions that are highlighted right now, releasing those now, and then allowing us to release the others in the next few months as the financial position of the county is a little more clear. And I appreciate your attention to this matter.
Okay. On the second sheet of the spreadsheet, SW1, is that what that is? At the top, third from the top.
Social worker one.
That is not an investigator.
That position is in foster care. And basically, that's one of the positions that works with the foster children, helping to reunite them with their parents.
Okay, and I understand why that would be important, but I also feel that maybe an investigator would also be important in lieu of that one, if that's what has to be.
Do we have
Could Susan speak to that?
Yes,
maybe
Susan.
That would probably clarify that.
We don't. We've had the manager has lifted our investigators. We do have two child support agents that are establishment that are not included in that. One, which was on the original freeze list, one that since then we've had a resignation. So we have two child support investigators agents that are, you only see one here, but we actually have two. And I'd just like to add that some of our positions at social services carry reimbursement, and this looks at it as if they were 100% funded by the county. So the child support agents get 66% reimbursement. So you're only funding 34% of those positions. Our income maintenance positions carry 50% reimbursement, and some of our child welfare carry between 35 and 40%.
So these figures need to be readjusted?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they would need to be to include some the reimbursement. The county does pay it out, but we receive it reimbursement on some of our positions.
Okay. What area is your accounting taking into?
I'm sorry.
What area is the accounting tech?
Tech is in our personnel department. Does payroll.
Okay.
And it's been vacant since, for 188 positions. It's been vacant since April of 2008.
I'm looking at MIS on Programmer Analyst 1. Mm-hmm. And I know that he has sent his programmers out to all the other departments. And I think that one of the things that would be very important is that we really consider this one for the running of the county and so forth. We all have computers just about, and when they go down, we all panic. And we have a problem if it would be a problem if that happened right. Here in the county. So that I would suggest as a consideration.
This position is a position that has been vacant only for a couple of months, and it's actually a COBOL programmer, and so it's a very specialized position. It is a position that he definitely needs. He's sort of been working around it, and like I said, all of these vacancies are taking a toll on the rest of the staff that's left behind.
I'm sure. Okay, and then going back to our audit, Ms. Loy. And she did emphasize on at least two or three occasions that the freeze that we did put into effect was very instrumental and kept us in very good shape. She did also mention that the local option sales tax decreased. So as we go forward, I think it'd be very important that we proceed with caution, mm-hmm. optimistic process here. Finances. What is your take on this?
Well, I think we would be fine releasing the 16 critical positions. I think that would be my recommendation. We're just in freezing the others. Some of the ones that we had originally frozen at the time of the budget, and we had to release some of those critical positions. We lost a little bit of that revenue. So by keeping those remaining 15 frozen, it helps us to gain that back. But releasing the critical ones, I think we'll be fine.
Okay. My point is just we'll move forward cautiously, mm-hmm. optimistically cautious. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
I'd like to make a motion, Madam Chair, that we...
May I point out some figures?
I'm sorry. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I didn't know we were going to jump into that quick. Our budget was done assuming, I think, that we would make a change mid-year. The savings were predicted just for the period that we were assuming we would have the freeze.
As of December 31st.
But believe it or not, I want to give you some good statistics rather than bad. Believe it or not, I can find them occasionally, contrary to some belief. If you look at the number of employees in the county government in relation to the population, the county, North Carolina County Commissioners Association faxed me this back in March of 2007, believe it or not, but I think statistically we still are probably in the same ballgame. Ballpark. Out of 100 counties, Alamance County's ranking as far as employees per population unit, a unit of population, we ranked 18th. In other words, there were only 17 other counties that had a better ratio or a more conservative ratio, if you want to call it that, of numbers of employees per unit of population. And believe it or not, there are some strange scenarios in there. You've got Mecklenburg that's higher than us. I mean, the ratio's better than us in Wake, but I think there you would determine, well, that's mainly a municipal county anyway. That whole county is a municipality, practically. So you do have some evaluation differences. On the negative side, I don't know what they do in Randolph unless they just don't get it done, or maybe they just get it done so much better. I don't know. I still think we need to keep looking at the goods and bads of everybody, but Randolph's rated number 2 in the state as far as numbers of employees per unit, but we're 18th, so that means there's, 82 other counties where the ratio is definitely worse than ours, and I think that's impressive. And then if you go over and look at the there's another chart put out by the North Carolina County Commission Association. This was faxed to me in December 9th of this year. There are 5 counties that's in a population range of 134 to 148,000, 5. And we're kind of dead in the middle of that ranking. Now, of those 5, the other four, we're one of them. Four have less employees than. But if you get in there and look at what they're doing versus what we're doing, and departments that we have that they don't have, programs that we have, for instance, with the federal government that they don't have, and so forth and so on, we're still looking good with our peers. And I just wanted to bring that to everybody's surprise, a piece of good news.
That's great.
So I support your motion if it's well. Go ahead and make your motion.
Well, I'm sorry, I hadn't said it.
But
thank you. When we prepare the budget every year, and of course, department heads, they do an outstanding job as far as their request. Knowing that when you add additional personnel, you know, that's where, you know, when you talk about the growth of government, mm-hmm. that's where it really hits you when you add positions. And an example, I know. 2 years ago, there were like 27 positions that were requested, and I think 5 were approved. So, you know, from the get-go, staff has done a great job. Management has done a good job in keeping those positions down. So, you know, when you look at these 31 positions, 16 critical need, I say absolutely they're critical need. And when you look at, you know, how we've done as far as revenues, and I think sales tax was up slightly instead of down, if I'm not mistaken.
But Amy can answer. She mentioned the local option sales tax.
Yeah, so across the board, so far, we have held our own. But we need to be careful, and I certainly appreciate that. And my motion was going to be that we go ahead and approve the 16 critical positions. That's my motion, Madam Chair.
I'll second that.
Yes, motion. All in favor?
Aye.
And I want to thank Sherry and all the department heads who worked hard to get all this done for us, and I appreciate that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. The next thing that we have is the budget amendments, 77 and 78 from Social Services. And just to let Mr. Shee know, if it says Social Services, it's probably going to be Susan Osborne, okay?
I know her.
Okay.
You might have somebody else speak.
Sometimes she has a feeling, but this time it'll be Susan.
These are just two quick budget amendments. Budget Amendment 77 is an additional $1,500 in our Share the Warmth program. That's through Piedmont Natural Gas. And there's no county dollars. That just adds $1,500 to our fund that we use to help folks with energy heating-related crisis. We did get additional federal funds, $136,914, which takes to our crisis intervention money to $501,000, which is $500,000. It's the most we've gotten in several years and a result of some of the federal stimulus funds. So we're right at $500,000 in our crisis intervention program. There's no county match for that either. This is just a budget amendment adding that to our budget so we can spend it with residents, citizens.
Any questions for Susan? Do I hear a motion that we accept? Yes. Have a motion?
Second.
All in favor?
Second.
Thank you.
Thank you, Susan. Okay, the next is, Jason Martin, manager.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, good morning.
Mm-hmm.
Before you, you have a memorandum from me regarding the planning board appointments. This time we had a unusually large number of planning board appointments. There were five openings this time. One, Thomas Jones from Pleasant Grove Township, who is eligible to be reappointed. The other four are members that have, by the planning ordinance that was established, are ineligible to be reappointed. Under the planning ordinance, it allows for two consecutive three-year terms, after which the planning board member that is outgoing must sit out for a year, and then they can reapply to be reappointed back to the planning board. That is the way that the current planning ordinance is written, and as you all, some of you may recall, we amended that ordinance about a year ago. I think it was around July of 2007 was the first reading on that ordinance. And we amended that to change from having 15 members and a commissioner to having 12 members and a commissioner that did not have voting power. And that was so that if there was anything where the commissioners had to have a final vote, they would be able to vote on that at the commissioners' meeting. Otherwise, it would be inappropriate and they would have to recuse themselves. At that time, we created three alternate positions and nine regular positions. And we did the nine regular positions based off of the seniority and the length of time they had been on the board, and the alternate positions as the newer people that had just been appointed to the board. That is something that when we amended that ordinance, we did not change the term limit requirement. That was in there from the 1977 ordinance that established the planning board. Today, there are four members that are ineligible to be reappointed. Those are Mike Wilson, Ernie Corey, who is also the chairman of the planning board, Jay Burke, who is the vice chairman of the planning board, and Ray Cobb. Two of which, it came to my attention, had applied and requested to be reappointed and to have the board to hear their reappointments. And what I had done as well, you should have attached with that, is an opinion that I got from the legal department. I requested that to make sure that I wasn't misinterpreting our ordinance, that there was not something in there that where a waiver could be granted or anything like that. And you should have that as well from Clyde Albright. I know that Ray and Jay both are here, and they may want to say a few words as well to the board, and that is all that I have for y'all at this time.
Is this the full ordinance, or is it just some?
That's just an opinion, a summary of that portion
but
of the ordinance.
But it's not full ordinance.
No, the full ordinance is only about a two-page ordinance. It's a short
one. Why weren't we given a copy of that, or were we?
No, I did not include that in with the packet this time.
Yeah.
I apologize for that, sir.
I'd like to make a comment, and I know Ray and Jay are both here, and having served on the planning board,
mm-hmm.
and I can't tell you strong enough what a wonderful job these people have done. I know for a fact that at least Ray, I'm not sure about Jay, but I know Ray was there when he was sick and should have been home and in bed. These are very dedicated people. But on the other hand, if we have this ordinance that says and limits your term, I think we need to go with it that we can't grandfather it in, because they have done a wonderful job. They're very dedicated people. I commend you for what you've done. My suggestion is wait a year, take a little vacation, enjoy the kids, the grandkids, and reapply. That's my suggestion.
Madam Chair, if I can just add to that, what Ms. Vaughn was saying, I would say as well that Jay and Ray both, there is absolutely nothing personal in this at all from staff's point of view. I think both of them have been outstanding planning board members. Jay has been an excellent vice chairman. They've been very supportive and helpful with staff and providing me information that I need to help make good recommendations as best I can. I need them as much as I need anybody or my planning board members. And I do want to publicly say that because I probably have not ever done it, and I would like to do that. And I would say that about all my planning board members. They are an outstanding bunch. I think they take some very unfair criticism at times. We get accused of being a board of developers and builders. Totally not the case. It's one of the things I'm most proud of is it's a very diverse board. We have an accountant on the board. We have a banker on the board. Do we have builders and developers? Yes, but we do not have a majority of builders and developers. That is something that that we have really put together, a very diverse board, and it's something I would like to continue with that planning board. And I would like to see it broader, more townships included, because we have some townships that don't have representation at all on the planning board. And also, I would add that I have spoken with some other places, particularly the city of Burlington, regarding that. And typically, everybody has a term limit in place on their boards. In some cases, they do have a provision in there to allow a temporary waiver. So, for example, if we had four openings and we didn't have any applicants this time, that way we can continue to do business, that the board would be able to give a temporary waiver to those people. And Claude may be able to elaborate a little more on that, if what's the standard protocol, you know, to be able to continue to do business. I think it's pretty much an understanding that the current board sits until you have them replaced. But that's all that I have.
Jason, I'd like to make just one comment. Sure. To what you were just saying. I do think we need representation from all areas of our county, and I don't know how we go about it. Maybe Sue Dayton here might have an idea, because what she was saying is a good idea to get it out, make sure people know about these appointments, because average citizen do not know how to, when to, what to.
I would agree with that, and I think Ms. Dayton brought up a very good point. One of the things I think the planning department needs is we need a face in the public. We really do need to go to the communities as best that we can, gather input. I want to do, obviously, as a director, I want to do the best that I can to represent what the public wants, within the bounds of the law, obviously. And I think as well the board wants the best information possible to be able to make informed decisions, and I think that's safe to say that our planning board wants that as well.
We do need the diversification. I noticed I don't even think there's going to be anybody from the city of Burlington here, is it?
No.
Which, I mean, you know, that's part of Alamance County also, so we need to take that in consideration as we're going through to next year's appointments.
Jason, about a year ago we discussed this and decided, I thought, that we would put these boards and commissions on the website with terms that people would, you know, their term would end in 2009 or 2011 and so forth. Is that not still on there?
It is not, and right now the county's in the process of redoing our county website, and once the and I just happen to be on the website committee. Once that is done, that is one of my items that I wanted to do. The biggest thing I wanted to get up there were the minutes, the agendas, things like that, and try to improve the communication with the public. I felt like that was a problem. There, for me, I have to rewind, taking over the planning department, there were a lot of things that I needed to deal with immediately that were a much bigger concern at that time. But I think communication is one of the big issues now that I want to deal with. And that's something I hope to have resolved by spring this year.
I know several months ago we received a packet with all the boards and commissions and the dates, but I thought all that was on the website, but evidently it's going to be.
I've been looking at a few other counties as to how they do that, and they'll actually advertise their board openings and things like that on the website. I think it's a great idea, and that's something I would like to
do. Well, legally, if we allow this to, you know, and I know both of these guys too, and they're friends of mine. I've been knowing them a long, long time. But we would have to amend our ordinance order to do that legally, or possibly we could face a lawsuit.
And
if we didn't do it.
Yeah, that's my understanding as well. And
is that right, Mr.?
The board can amend the ordinance any way they consider appropriate.
Right, but I mean, if we allow them to stay without amending the ordinance, then we could definitely be
could possibly
have a lawsuit from somebody that may have wanted to be on the board too.
Didn't you have the opportunity a short while back to make that change, and the change wasn't made? The board did not vote to make the change, but keep the ordinance as it was.
Well, we'll put it this way. I did not propose changing that at the time when we amended the ordinance. And at that time, I mean, the planning board could have suggested that we do that. But as a matter of fact, I went back and listened to the planning board meeting, the recording of that particular meeting, and I had explained that we were going to retain this, and it passed unanimously. So
there was an opportunity.
Yeah.
How many members are, is it in the ordinance as to how many members there are to be?
Yeah, it's 12 members total, nine regular members, three alternates, and one county commissioner. And the county commissioner would not have voting power.
Okay. Is it in the ordinance? Again, we should have had a copy of this. Is it in the ordinance that each person has to be from a certain district?
It states that no more than two members can come from any specific township, and no more than one member can sit as a regular member on the board from any township.
Okay. Are there any at-large members?
No, there's not, and that's an interesting point. We don't have any at-large members on our board.
Is it in the ordinance as to how it's to be handled if more than one person for one slot applies? How is that?
How we've handled that before.
What's in the ordinance?
Yeah, the ordinance doesn't provide for a specific procedure for that. It doesn't. And we had that come up when we first established the board or established those rules, and we basically allowed the two members to decide which wanted to be an alternate based on their personal schedules and which one could commit to being a regular member. And we let them decide that.
Okay.
Well, if they came down to all things equal, that's how we
What if they can't come to that conclusion? It's not very thorough, is it?
Yeah, there's really not a procedure to allow for that.
I mean, I wouldn't have a problem voting on. I mean, we vote on Alamance Community College Board of Trustees when there's more than one person applying. The thing that I've got a problem with here, and I know I'm going to go negative here, I sense more politics here than I do protocol. Now, you can sit back and say that I'm going negative or how do you know? I said, I believe there's more politics here than there is protocol. And that's what I got a serious problem with as far as government goes. We have a chance. And I don't see people standing in line. And I don't think it's because we haven't solicited involvement. But I don't see people standing in line for these slots. So, you know, I have a problem with trying to orchestrate a certain mentality on our board, and I think that's what I'm sensing more than protocol. Now, I could be wrong. I have a right to sense this. I have a right to believe this and or think it. And, you know, we've got two people here, and I can look them square in the eye and tell them that I have some differences with them on their zoning beliefs. I have some differences with them on their adequate facilities beliefs. So it has nothing to do with philosophy or friendship. It's just that I believe that we have two good people who we could accommodate their involvement and get new people as well by a simple revision of the ordinance that would allow at large, for instance, and or vote between the two if there's more than one slot, you know. So I would like to make a motion that we amend our ordinance to go with the appointments of people who have applied that have not been on there, and they're obviously their terms, you know, they haven't even had a term. But I would like to amend our ordinance to where we have at large membership. If we have to study that, fine. Can't get a second, fine. I'm not going to worry about that. But I can't be a part of a political orchestration more than a protocol orchestration.
And Madam Chair, if I can, just to kind of follow up on what Mr. Sutton was saying, I think if there was an amendment to the ordinance, I just want to clarify, and Clyde, County Attorney, please correct me if I'm wrong. In order to amend the ordinance, we would not be able to do that today. We actually have to call a public hearing to do that. But we could, if that's the case, then I would say that it needs to be tabled, any appointments, and then call a public hearing to amend the ordinance.
Well, we could, Jason, we could go ahead and do the appointments that are not in question today, couldn't we? I don't see a problem with that.
I
agree with you.
Yeah.
I think
still leaving it short.
Proceed on with that.
Yeah.
And as far as at large, Tim, I'm a little confused because not all the townships are represented, yet you may have two from one township already on there. So you do have somewhat of an at large already in place.
Yeah.
I don't think you do, but.
And this would be, I'm just asking for clarification that this would be to make an motion to amend the ordinance to include the, go ahead and appoint the ones, the new people that have applied. There's three new applicants and the one reappointment.
Yeah, that's not under in question.
Okay, so that would make four appointments, and then we've got five open positions and two people left.
Yeah.
So we would also need to change that to allow at large positions and extend the number of people on the board, basically. Okay. I'm just asking that for my own clarification.
How many people are on the board now that aren't up for renewal now that have exceeded their terms?
None.
Okay. So what's their motion?
Just that we go ahead and approve those four that are not, or we vote on those four that are not in question, which is Tommy Bray,
Jones.
Kevin Clark,
Jones.
Yeah, Thomas L.J. Jones, and Brenda Lloyd, that we go ahead and vote on those today. And then we're tabling the others because we're going to look at the planning ordinance. Yeah.
Yeah, I think it needs to be looked at, too.
Okay. And what kind of time frame can we expect on that? Can we request?
Yeah, we can. I think Clyde has something
for
us.
When you want
next, yeah, we
next,
can have it done.
Next meeting.
Next meeting.
Okay. Next meeting.
All right. Yep. And I'll second your motion.
It'll be done.
All right. Okay. I have a motion on that and a second.
Right.
All in favor of that?
Aye.
Any comments? All right. You're up again.
I'll make this as quick as I can as well. What you have before you now is an appeal for an illegal junkyard that has been cited. So Dewey Smithy, who I know is here in attendance today, doing business at D&W Motors. They're located off of Union Ridge Road across from Lake Camac. And I'm going to just jump right into the pictures here. These are some photos that were taken in August of 2008. And this is actually on the site, Mr. Smithy. After we contacted him and requested permission to enter the site, he did grant that. And these are some photos that we have taken. This is a duplicate of that one picture, a little bit closer. Okay, and the High Impact Land Use Ordinance, Polluting Industries Ordinance, just to kind of summarize, provides spacing requirements for the location of high impact land uses from protected facilities. Junkyards are regulated by this ordinance and are defined as a yard or lot used to store junk, such as scrap metal or resellable car parts. High impact land uses are required to be a minimum of 2,000 feet away from any church, hospital, dwelling, or other protected facility. And I believe in the memorandum it has a list of all of those. This is just a scan of the aerial of the property there in the area. And this is a watershed aerial on the right, which is where the property is located at, is actually in the balance of the watershed. On the other side of the road is the critical area. Now, under the watershed ordinance, critical watersheds, junkyards are not allowed at all, but it's close enough that I felt we should present that. And the basis of the appeal, the appellant, this is from the planning board meeting, stated that there had been a junkyard on the site before his operation began in 1980. applicant stated that he purchased a license previously but was never told that he was not in compliance or needed to reapply for a permit. Cars cannot be seen from the road, and that efforts have been made to keep cars 30 to 40 feet from neighboring property lines. And then also a statement of why should his property be cited when there are other several others that have not been cited. And I just kind of go down each one of these. Number one, stating that they have been there since 1980, and there had actually been a junkyard on site before 1980. This is an aerial from 1974. The area down there that's been zeroed in is the actual site, and I'm going to zoom in on that for you now. That's from 1974. I don't really see any evidence of a junkyard there, cars scattered about or anything like that. Here's an aerial from 1984. Now, there is a building at the front at the property, and from my understanding is that was a convenience store at one time, and eventually was turned into a used car lot for Mr. Smithy. But again, you see the rest of the property there. There's really nothing there. Now, from between 1984 and 1995 is when the cars showed up. And I apologize, we do have 1989 aerials. Those are in storage, and I was unable to locate the aerial for this particular site. We don't have those scanned in. But this is from 1995, and clearly you can see cars are there. And now from 2000, this is from our GIS, and then 2005. So that's just a timeline of the history of the site.
Pull back, excuse me, can you go back to the photograph and pull back? Is that's Lake Camac? What lake is that?
That's a pond.
That's a pond on the side.
No, the large, or to the left.
Yeah, Lake Camac's on the left.
Okay, was that a watershed?
It is.
That's what he was saying. One side is critical, one's not.
Yeah. And when I did a register of deed search, this is an assumed business name certificate that Mr. Smithy filed with the register of deeds, and I'm just trying to determine a little bit better as to when his operation began. This was filed in 1985. Number two, the applicant stated that he purchased a license previously but was never told that he was not in compliance or needed to reapply for a permit. This is an actual copy of the permit. Now, as you may recall, prior to the high impact land use ordinance, permits were issued, automobile graveyard permits were issued through the inspections department. This is an application, and I spoke with our inspections department about this. I wanted to make sure that this is not actually a permit, but it was an application for a permit from 1994. You'll see down there it says that it final and it passed. Permit expired, General Statute 153A 358, and I would ask either the inspections folks or legal staff to correct me if I'm wrong on this, but I believe that is when the permit expires due to lack of activity is typically when that is used. And that's that. Say you start building a house and never call in for an inspection on it. And then after so many years, 3 years or 4 years, the permit will automatically expire. Now this is from 2003. This is after, you'll see there's a difference on the other side there where description of works is other, junkyard complaint. And this is another application for a permit. And down there at the bottom you see all of the activity that was done by the inspections department at that time, every time it was rejected for inspection. Now, a lot of the times nobody was on the property when the inspector went, and I think that's a point of contention for Mr. Smithy, but I'll let him speak to that. But this is just to kind of show these things were done. Basis of appeal number three, cars cannot be seen from the road, and efforts have been made to keep cars 30 to 40 feet from neighboring property lines. Here's some photos that the planning department took in November of 2008. These are from the road. And I'll just ask the board if you can see junk cars from the road. And now this is another point I would like to bring up is you see that the car is there with the property lines. Now granted, our GIS is not 100% accurate. It can be off a little bit, but I don't think it's off 100 feet or anything like that, and certainly not enough to for the cars that are actually located on the neighbor's property. And then number four, why should his property be cited when there are several others that have not been cited? And this is my staff response. Just to reiterate, all citations are derived on a complaint basis and not by staff. Complaints are handled on a case-by-case basis, and if warranted, citations are issued. Dewey Smithy, doing business as D&W Motors, is the appellant, and junkyard operations at the site is what is being considered in this case. Consideration of other junkyards, legal or illegal, is irrelevant and inappropriate at this time, as they are not the appellants. If the appellant would like to file a complaint with our office regarding another site, we encourage him to do so, and our staff will research the potential violation and enforce any appropriate and applicable ordinances. Now, the planning board recommendation, and there are several planning board members here today, available for questions, I'm sure. The planning board voted in majority with one dissenting member to recommend approval of the appeal. The planning board's recommendation was based primarily on the grandfather clause of the high impact land use polluting industries ordinance, since conditions at the site existed prior to the adoption of the ordinance. And additionally, the board questioned whether enforcement action could or should be taken based upon their perceived lack of county enforcement in the past. Now, from my understanding as well regarding this matter, is that this appeal should be taken if Mr. Smithy wants to appeal the staff's decision. I've been advised that this should be taken to court, should be taken to Superior Court at this time, and that the planning board's recommendation actually would not be relevant or appropriate in this case. And I would defer to Mr. Albright if he has anything he wants to add on that.
The key to this, if you grandfather something in, it must be in lawful existence at the time of the high impact land use ordinance, which was September of 2006. Since he was not a non-conforming legal use at that time, he wasn't permitted, he wasn't following the rules at that time, then it cannot be grandfathered in because it's a non-conforming illegal use. It must be lawful under the laws of the state of North Carolina. So you can't grandfather in an illegal use.
And one other thing, that this morning, prior to the meeting, one of the residents presented to me a petition that I'll just read to you right now. We, the undersigned residents of the Union Ridge community, urge you, the county commissioners, to support the recommendation of the planning department to close the unlawful junkyard owned by Dewey Smithy, located at 4825 Union Ridge Road in Burlington. And these are two sets of signatures on legal paper.
You'll make those part of the record?
Yeah.
I think that'd be appropriate.
I'm going to let Mr. Smith comment at this point. Mr. Smith, you are ready to comment at this time?
That's not
him. Or is I don't know Mr. Smith. Although this guy wanted to come in after Jason. Yeah. That's Bill Smith.
Good morning, commissioners. I'm not a whole lot of a speaker. I've been a hard worker all my life. I know how to do that well. All I can say is I bought this piece of land in 1980. Before that, I haul junk cars out of Alamance County in the gullies, in the fields, in the woods. Trees growed up through them. The other junk dealers wouldn't touch them.
Could you pause just a moment? Can you hear him in the back? Or can, would you mind speaking up? I've heard complaints before that people in the back can't hear, and I know they're interested. I'm sorry.
I try to respect the law. When I'm notified about buying a license, I buy it. I applied for a license when they first started them, and I bought them for 3 years. They told me that they discontinued the license. About a year ago, I was notified they started buying them again by another junk dealer. So I went and applied, and they wouldn't sell them to me. How do you obey the law when you're not notified what the law is?
What was their reason for not selling them to you, Mr. Smith?
I don't know, ma'am.
I mean, what did they say?
The reason that they're here today, I guess. I try to respect my neighbors. I keep the junk back from their houses, but that don't seem to be good enough. It's not only they don't want a junkyard, they don't want no type business there, period. Don't make no difference what it is, a store, whatever it may be, they don't want any kind of business there. They even say the mosquitoes in the cars bothers them sitting on the front porch. Well, when you live at a city lake, do you reckon that's a good place for mosquitoes? And when you got a pond about 60 foot from your house, do you think that's a good mosquito den? All I ask is whatever needs to be resolved on it, resolve it in a sensible way. I work for a living. I need my job. I'm too old to start over on another job. That's about all I can say.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Can we put back up on the board there when we rejected some stuff?
Sure.
I didn't catch all that.
The actual copies of the permits?
Yeah, or the dates and the time
frame. Oh, okay. Yeah. This is the first one from 1994. And what it says at the bottom there is highlighted in yellow is that it was passed, and then it says permit expired per general statute. And my understanding is that general statute is due to a lack of activity, it expires. So it was never called in for an inspection or anything like that. And then in 2003, this is off of it originates with a complaint. And everything was rejected starting, looks like April 24th of 2003, and there are six rejections going through May 5th of 2004.
Okay, rejections for
the what? Rejections, this would have fallen under a different ordinance at the time, but nobody there, is junk behind the buildings. This is to bring the property into compliance with the ordinance at the time.
Okay. Now, that wasn't the junk car. That wasn't the ordinance, the newest ordinance, right?
No, this is a preceding ordinance.
What were the legal avenues available to us as a result of those rejections?
Under the automobile graveyard ordinance, to be honest with you, I don't really know offhand because the planning department didn't enforce that ordinance.
Okay.
Inspections did.
Fine.
We could move to enforce the ordinance, send him a notice of violation if he ignored it, take him to court for judicial enforcement. We also could have gotten the health department involved and started an action under the health department statutes.
You weren't here then, right?
No, that was before my time.
The reason why we didn't do it, I mean. See, what my point is if there were no avenues, and that's what I got to get in my mind, if there were no avenues of handling those rejections to go forward for the future, you know, then, you know, then you have a mighty fine line there as to whether it was a grandfather potential.
Under the same line of thought, he could have gone and gotten a judge to issue an injunction stating that he was grandfathered in 1994. That wasn't right. And there are other junkyards in this county that are operated legally in accordance with law and are permitted. So they follow the rules.
But you're saying by those rejections there, we had avenues on the books to proceed with
cleaning it up
or shutting it down or whatever, right?
And yes. One thing I wanted to just kind of add as well is that environmental health actually did, now this didn't do with the cars, this was a solid waste violation. Environmental health did get involved apparently in 2003 through 2005. And I believe this was actually taken to court by Environmental Health for a solid waste violation. That would be a different violation in general. That would be more with storing tires and scrap metal, things like that.
What was the
That's what I'm skimming through here to. I apologize, I don't have it here. It just says that there was a summons in August.
I think it was a summons issued, and I went to court, and I think it was maybe a $115 fine that was paid by Mr. Smithy, and the prayer for judgment continued on the condition that you clean up whatever was out there at that time. Does that sound right, Mr. Smithy?
Well, the whole order of it, sir, was there was about 60 gas tanks laying on the ground. I pulled off the cars, and being she had to pay to get rid of them, haul them all the way to Kernersville, I have to haul about 300 at a time, and you have to get the gas out of them, you have to knock holes in them, and you have to mash them, and you have to haul them all the way to Kernersville to get rid of them. And I can't haul 60 at one time. I have to haul a load on the sheriff.
Can you pull up the property lines again where it shows the property and the cars from the top of that right there? Okay. Now, where you've got several cars located across the property line. Now, that's on someone else's property.
Mm-hmm.
Now, has there ever been any court cases on that, Mr. Smithy, where you've been sued for having vehicles on that person's property?
I was supposed to move them. I moved about 80 of them off of it.
But you didn't get them all?
You can't get them all when it's muddy.
But that's been about, how long was that suit? That's about 20 years ago, wasn't it?
No, it ain't been 20 years ago.
How long was it?
Been about 4 or 5 years ago.
Okay.
Must have been muddy. We were in a drought.
So that's still standing out there, civil case is still there, and you were told to move the cars.
There's about 4 vehicles sitting on someone else's property.
Any more comments, questions?
Well, we're weighing your right to do business out here, and I understand that, versus public health and safety.
Jason,
yes, ma'am.
I know the other junkyards have to have fences around them.
Areas.
Around their areas. Does he not fall in that area as well?
Well, under the graveyard ordinance that was in at the time, it would have had to have either fencing or some type of vegetative buffer to screen it. excuse me. That is correct. And under the current ordinance, if you were to apply for a new graveyard or new junkyard permit under the high impact land use ordinance, same thing. It would have to be on a 10-acre tract of land, which that's one thing I did not point out. This property's not 10 acres. It's right. Maybe 3 acres.
But when he started it, he didn't have to have 10 acres.
I'm sorry?
He didn't have to have that 10 acres when he first started.
No. And if he were to apply for the, under the current ordinance, you have to have 10 acres. Right. And then there was also screening requirements, buffering, fencing, that sort of thing under that.
Yeah, I have the ordinance and right here. And so that's why I was wondering. So he didn't comply actually at all.
Right. And I don't have record where there was a permit issued. Mm-hmm. And what Mr. Smithy is saying, if he says that he obtained a permit, even if that's the case, those permits lasted for 3 years. So there would have been a lapse of all this time in permit as well.
Jason, what is the time span of Mr. Smithy cleaning this up? What are we looking at on that end? Should we go forward with enforcing this?
We would have to give 30 days. Am I correct on that?
If we just ordered him to clean it up, we work with him on it.
Right. Yeah.
We're not going to expect him to remove all of that within 30 days. It'd probably take him 60 days to get rid of all.
Okay.
And I will say, that is our goal, is to work with people. I mean, we try to do that, and it's a two-way street. Now, I will say as well that we have had another junkyard that cleaned their property up in, I think, 8 days.
So if he comes into compliance, then he can, but would he be able to even have it if he
cleaned it up.
No.
Because he didn't have under the current.
Was there someone else that wanted to speak to this? Or, okay.
Not on that.
Mr. Smith? Yes, sir.
Where this junkyard's sitting at, it does not hurt. There's no way it can harm anybody. I drilled a well 400 foot deep, and it went in pipe clay and sand rock 380 foot deep. The cars are sitting on land that does not absorb anything in it. And as far as applying for license, I applied when I did, and he's talking about stuff that didn't exist back in 1980 that does exist now. This same way with a lot of the houses in the area. If they would go to build them today, they wouldn't give them a permit to build them because it wouldn't hurt. But back in 1970s and 80s, they built them anyway, whether it hurt or not.
Over in Guilford, you were over there when Hennis had his problem.
Yes, sir.
Hometown Road. What did they use to, what was the deal on that?
They used the general statutes, nuisance abatement. In that case, they got a court order to clean it up. They gave him time to clean it up, and he refused. And so they hired D.H. Griffin to clean it up in one day. And then billed him for the cleanup cost.
Y'all familiar with that case?
Yeah, I remember that.
Sure.
Yeah. Okay.
Paint in the back.
Yes, sir.
Yes, ma'am. I'd like for Jason to clarify, if you would. He said under the high impact land use ordinance that cars could not be seen from the road. Is that correct?
No.
Okay, so cars can be seen from the road.
It has to be on... they have to be properly screened. It has to be screened in, and it has to be on a 10-acre tract of land.
Okay, but screening is to prevent people from seeing them from the road.
And neighboring properties.
But if the lay of the land makes it aware that the cars can be seen a long ways, then how would they buffer that?
Well, in that case, assuming that all things are eligible to obtain a permit, we would work with them to see if what the existing land, how it lays, if that would suffice as a buffer.
So the ordinance is a discretionary per person.
Well,
the rules don't apply the same to everybody.
The ordinance has specific requirements for fencing.
But now we're talking about buff or to make them where you can't see them from the road.
Okay. But that screening buffer yard, is that what he's talking about?
Yes.
On page
four. There's a landscaping plan required
to keep the cars from being able to be seen from the road. Correct.
I think in looking at some of the photographs, look like some of the cars are in right away of the road.
I understand that, but this ordinance affects more than one person.
Right.
So there are individual people that history might could not be seen from the road.
Madam Chair, the word used is minimizes. The visual impact, it doesn't say completely obliterates it. It said minimizes it. Because if you have a hill or a valley,
right,
of course you're going to be able to see
some. Yeah.
But it says you put the buffer up to minimize the visual impact and maximize the buffering of noise and particulate matter. That's on page 6.
I was reading the one on page 4.
And on page 5 specifies a 100-foot screening buffer alongside and rear property lines not adjoining a road, and have or plant a 50-foot screening buffer along all other property lines excluding driveways or entrances to the premises.
Now, Alamance County does permit under the graveyard permit, yards that do not meet these eligibility requirements, correct?
You want me to answer that?
Please, address that for us.
Okay, go ahead.
If they're in lawful operation on the date the ordinance was passed, then they can be grandfathered. But they must be maintained in lawful operation.
So the rules don't apply to them. They do.
The reason
they don't have to go under the new rules, they are grandfathered.
If they are in lawful operation, and the reason is that was put into our law, is to prevent people from being forced out of business when they are in lawful operation when an ordinance is changed. God bless you. But that's the reason that's put in there.
But to the strict letter of the code,
everybody will have
to go to the strict letter of the code in Alamance County? Or are you using discretion?
We follow the letter and the spirit of the law.
Right.
To the best of my ability, that's what I'm going to do.
Yeah, I see the minimizes the visual impact. I see that right here.
Yeah.
On page 6.
Okay.
Mr.
Madam, may I say something?
Yes, sir.
Please?
Yes, sir.
This was a registered, insured, bonded business in the state of North Carolina for 28 years. It wasn't a place where it just went out here and opened up the doors and tried to break the lock.
And, Madam Chair, if I may ask, is that currently still the case? Is that currently still the case, that it's bonded and insured?
It's still insured and it's still bonded.
And what type of business has it insured and bonded as?
As a garage and a graveyard.
Okay.
You want to see the pilot?
I was asking that in regards to the dealership as well.
I don't sell used cars anymore because nobody buys.
Okay.
It's a tough.
We need, yeah. Clyde, do you have anything you want to add to this situation? I mean, this is a legal situation, the way I see it.
Yeah, it is, and I don't know that it's our judgment.
Mr. Smith, you do have a right to appeal any decision, I think, that we
he can appeal to the Superior Court.
Right.
But there again, the court's going to follow the law. It's got to be, any nonconforming use has to be lawful at the time the ordinance was passed. If it's not lawful, then it can't be grandfathered.
Yes, ma'am.
This was the one that sold Miss Smith the land. And I told him point blank when he started building a junkyard that I would not have sold him the property if he was going to do that. Well, he's on my property and has been on it for years, and he was told to remove it. When I took him to court, he has never removed it.
When was that, ma'am? When was that court?
You know what, I can't remember, but it's been several years ago. I think it was in like the late 1990-something or maybe 2000. He was given 12 days to remove it. And that's what the sheriff, deputy told me. And I knew he couldn't move it in 12 days, so I gave him 60. But still nothing happens, and he's been on my property for years and has paid me nothing.
Yes, sir.
This ordinance was controversial before it ever became an ordinance. It was spoken about last Tuesday night at the planning board meeting. This ordinance, and the only reason I'm saying the ordinance is because that's what's being used, is the ordinance. That ordinance by itself is not just, some people yes, some people no, but that ordinance is not only being, It's being used to destroy business. It's being used to destroy family. In my case, I spent hundreds of thousands of dollars. Not $10,000 or $20,000, hundreds of thousands of dollars to move to Castle County. But the worst thing out of it so far is that last Tuesday night, my whole contention was that Ray Cobb did not tell the truth.
Well, I don't think we're here to determine that. So, I mean, I think that's...
But this is what I was told by my dad that my niece has asked a question because him and my brother-in-law got into a heated discussion or argument over Ray Cobb.
Yeah, I think we don't need to go there, okay, and at this point, because we're talking about Mr. Smithy and not anything that involves anybody else, okay? That's okay. Yeah, I think we just, I don't think we need to go there at this point, okay? If it doesn't involve, I know what you're saying, because you're Tony, okay? But I think we just need to, if you want your case, you know, I told you to come back up.
And I'm sorry.
Okay.
You know how I like to talk.
I understand.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yes, ma'am. I hear to say that the main thing was that, in fact, whether before or after the ordinance being licensed, and by the way, excuse me, I'm Wayne Smithy, your son.
Okay.
So whether or not that was credibility toward him being legal business in operation before or after the ordinance. And clearly from y'all's own sites and files existing is D&W Motors and the graveyard. Well, they say there hadn't been a license bought since 3 years from purchase time, supposedly. They have been no good. Well, if that to be the case, how come we are still listed as existing graveyards?
Can we see that?
On y'all's own paperwork.
Y'all like to see this. Who produced this?
One of your offices.
Jason, do you know anything about it?
Bring anything up on the computer, because I don't have the education to do such, but surely
I know where that one is. These fall in Hall River's ETJ right here. That one does. This one falls in Burlington. That one falls in Burlington's ETJ. That one falls in, yeah, I know where that one is. I know where that one is. He falls in Graham's ETJ. These fall out of an ETJ right here. Well, one of them I think is in our in Hall River's ETJ. Okay, I know where all these are, but that last one.
Where this was produced. Do y'all have such a
these are
do you know, do you know where you out? Where you what office you
which office that? Provided that to you, sir?
I think it was the clerk's office.
Some
I'm
of these
not
are
sure now,
some
but
of these are
really come off of y'all's
yeah y'all's a lot of these are not our most of them are not our jurisdiction because they fall in either Mebane or Hall River or Burlington right. In their city limits or ETJs.
But, I think that's what she's saying.
I can understand that part of it.
It's
still in
here.
The question. D&W Motors is in your jurisdiction and it is on that list.
But it doesn't say it's a junkyard.
Yes, ma'am. Above it, it says
list of existing
graveyards.
Automobile graveyard. Okay. I don't know where it came from or why it says that. I really don't.
Do y'all have any type of files that everybody could pull up to see what's on y'all's records?
All the files that we have that I've pulled for graveyards that was enforced through the inspections department according to their records.
And
I provided that today.
At the same time.
Do we need to look at this?
All of these.
Let's go ahead.
That said,
yes.
Was not. My father there in order for it to be inspected to be rejected. And if he was not, they are subpoenas, they are judgment or whatever you do that could have made him there, made him liable.
not just come in the place and go over and do as you please, as you wish to do, and then say, well, ain't no good, and walk off and not tell him nothing, just like you didn't when you appeared. Now, what kind of county have we got?
Wait a minute.
I would say to that point, Ms. Vaughn and the rest of the board, that was an inspection. Those were inspections that were done by the Building Inspections Department under the Automobile Graveyard Ordinance. I cannot answer for them. The inspector that did the inspections no longer works here. He's retired. And I honestly don't know. Now, I think that goes to a broader point, though, as if you apply for a permit, for example, to build a house, is it the county's responsibility to come out to your property when you are there, or is it your responsibility to make yourself available?
Right. I'll speak to that one, because I know if I have them coming out and I'm not available or they can't get in the house, I have to follow up to see what the situation is. Right.
Mm-hmm. But was he notified they were coming?
Well, we don't know that.
Well, that's what I say. I mean, they try to make it look like
somebody paid for the permit.
Right. Somebody had. Yeah.
Motion.
Madam Chair. I'm asking for a motion.
I'll make a motion that we go ahead and deny the appeal, and that we side with the planning.
I'll second that.
I have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
No opposed. Okay. And Mr. Smithy can also appeal this. Is that not right, Mr. Allbright?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, to the court. Okay. Okay, Mr. Burgess, if you'll give us some interim county manager report.
Madam Chair, just have one matter. It deals with Jordan Lake rules, and I'm going to call on Clyde to update you on that.
We have joined with the City of Burlington, Bob Ward, Legal Department in Burlington, along with several other local governments, and hired a law firm to represent our interests in these rules, which I think will now have to be taken up before the legislature.
Okay.
I have money in my budget to pay about $5,000 for Alamance County towards this firm. And Burlington's going to pay some, and so are the other organizations.
What firm is that?
Kilpatrick Stockton. They're going to, City of Greensboro's also joined, and they're funding.
Hang on a minute, Clyde, we got some disturbance in here.
If y'all want to talk, can y'all move outside, please? Thank you.
The Rules Review Commission went ahead and passed the rules, and they are not favorable.
Oh, yeah, the Jordan Lake rules, you're right.
So we're taking a legal approach and a legislative approach.
Okay. Are they on that legislative conference goals, do you think, at all? I haven't read all of them.
I think they are. They should be.
You can bring them up.
Yeah. I think I have about two more days to add it to it. If it's not, I will check on that today.
Thank you.
I will.
I do have all of them. Thank you, Pat. Is that all, Mr. Burgess?
Oh, yes, ma'am.
Do you guys though have a time that you're going to meet, Clyde, with Burlington, or have you already done all this?
Pardon?
Is this all in place now with Burlington?
Yes.
Okay.
Because Bob Ward and I talked about this last summer.
Okay.
And I spoke with the City of Greensboro's council.
Okay.
We agreed that since our interests were mutual, that'd be the best way to approach it.
Okay. Next we go to the consent agenda. Anybody have any questions about the consent agenda?
Motion.
Second.
Motion and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. At this time, we will move.
Madam Chairman,
yes,
is anybody on this board going to go to the school board's meetings? Yeah, they're having a meeting Friday. Are you still on their liaison?
You talking about the workshop?
Yeah. Workshop.
I've received an invitation. It's going to be based on what my schedule looks like at work, that's what I'm in.
Well, if you can't go, I can.
My full time job. Thank
if you can't go, I can.
Can I ask a question too before you move on?
Well, may I?
I'm sorry.
Sure.
The reason I'm bringing this up is they're going to be discussing capacity and school, new school projections, mm-hmm. so forth and so on.
That.
And rather than it come out in the paper, or you know, I need to hear myself, and I would hope this board would, some logical discussion about their true capacity versus what their net capacity is. Because for years, we have seen fluctuating figures as to what a particular school could seat versus what it was currently seating. I sat here just a moment ago. I've got the current 2007-2008 building capacity. It's an official document out of the school system, dated June 16th of 08. And just in the high schools alone, in six schools, they've got 1,295 seats not going in the regular capacity. And they've got, that's not counting the mobile classroom capacity. So if you take into consideration the mobile capacities, Tim and I looked at some figures here, not looking at mobiles, but there were in the elementary, middle, and high school range, the total was over 5,000 seats, or close to 5,000 seats, that weren't in the capacity, gross capacity, but it was in the net capacity. And their answer, and informally, has been, in with my discussions, or casual comments with Wall, that where they use these other seats for other programs. But my Lord, 5,000 seats, and that's not counting mobile capacity. And if you've got 50 mobiles, you've got another 1,000. You've got potentially 6,000 seats
that are not being
that
used.
That aren't in the gross capacity. It's in, you know,
the areas.
And the Burlington school system, by itself, before it was merged with the county, was only 5,000 students, roughly. So I'm concerned about those numbers. And if anybody of you two go to that, please. I mean, we've got a situation here where in one school they're showing over 20 rooms being used for something other than normal capacity. And I just think some of these figures are absurd. And I hope that we can get some logical discussion.
Will you make me a copy of some of that?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
If I have to go to you.
Yes, ma'am.
If Dan can't go, I can go.
Okay. Sure. I scribbled on some of this.
Before you go any further.
Okay, Ann has a question.
It goes under the Commissioner's Committee Assignments. Mm-hmm. It's two of you serving on the Animal Services Task Force. Is that a misprint?
No, that was, they had requested that, if you remember, Ann, back when they started that about 2 years ago. They requested two of us to serve on that committee.
I thought, all right.
It was, Bill Ashley and myself were on that committee. Eddie and I are on it.
And I think that Board of Health, you got the that's not the third Tuesday, it's the second Tuesday. I can't remember, because one of them we had to change. Yeah. I'm thinking it's the Board of Health, Eddie. Do you know when that is? You're on that.
I think it's third Tuesday now.
Is it third?
Third Tuesday. Okay, good. That's good. Third Tuesday. Thank you. Thank you. Okay, we got that straight. Okay, anything else? Okay, at this point we are, since I finally taken it. Right now, under the General Statute Rules, I move that we now go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute Section 143-318.11A6 to consider the qualifications and conditions of appointment or conditions of initial employment of a public officer or employee. And I need a motion on that.
Yes.
Okay, Ann, motion second. And Dan Engel, we are now in going to closed session.
Where will we go? Can we go into personnel room?
This office is back here.
Well, I like to have a table right by.